Hey everyone, it's Gina, and in today's video, I am going to share with you some tips on how to pass your Versant test. 4 days ago, I uploaded 2 videos of mock Versant test, and those would not be complete without me discussing the tips on how to pass each stage of the test. So what is a Versant test? Versant is one of the most common language assessment that call center companies administer to gauge the level of fluency of their applicants. It usually has 6 stages, from part A to part F. According to Pearson, which is the company that created Versant, the goal of Versant is to measure the ability to understand spoken English on everyday topics and to respond appropriately at native-like conversational pace in intelligible English. In short, the goal of Versant is to measure your ability to speak in English and be understood in English. Versant, by the way, has 4 diagnostic subscores, which are sentence mastery, vocabulary, fluency, and pronunciation. Together, these scores will describe your fluency in English. Just a reminder before we start in the video that I will not be able to give you hacks and tricks to pass your Versant test. At the end of the day, this test, Versant, will do what it's supposed to do, what it's designed to do, and that is to measure your real fluency in the English language. What I can do for you in this video is to help you familiarize the 6 stages of the test and to help you prepare for what's coming and also help you practice the test before you do the actual test. This way, you will be less nervous. But at the end of the day, this test will do what it's supposed to do, and that is to gauge your actual English fluency. I can help you with the preparation, but at the end of the day, it's always going to be your English. By the way, I hear a lot of people who are saying that Versant is a dumb test. So dumb that you can just say a prayer like "Our Father who art in heaven" during the test and you would already be fine. As long as you say anything in English, you will pass the test. And honestly, I don't really know the answer to that. I wish I know, but I don't. But if you have experience taking the test and saying answers other than the correct ones, well, comment down below and let us know your experience, because I have not personally experienced butchering my test. I don't really know how dumb or how smart a Versant test is. But if I'm going to think about our technology right now, especially the voice recognition technology like Google, where we could already search through our voice, I don't think that's true. Honestly. Well, of course, I don't know. I have not experienced it. But I don't think that is true. For a software that's specifically designed to assess a human language, I think that it's just so far-fetched to say that Versant is that dumb, that if you say "Our Father who art in heaven," you would still pass. Or if you purposely say the wrong answer during the test, that you would pass. I mean, even Google could already detect what we are saying when we're searching through voice. How much more a software that is designed to assess a language specifically? Of course, there's always going to be limitations because it is a software. I just don't think that Versant could be that dumb, especially during the short answer questions. So it goes without saying that you need to give the correct answer during the test if you want to pass. But of course, if you want to experiment, you want to give the wrong answers, then you can do that too. But if you really want to pass, of course, it goes without saying that you should give the correct answer as much as you can. Before giving you the tips, I just want to remind you that you need to speak normally, not too loud, not too soft. You will also hear that reminder before the test.
Speaking tips. It is important to speak naturally during the test. Here are some tips. Speak at a normal speed, like you would during a conversation. Speak like you are talking to a person on the phone. There's no need to speak too carefully or slowly. Speak at a normal volume, not too loud or too soft.
And now, let's discuss the 6 stages of the Versant test. The first part, which is part A, is reading. In this test, a voice prompt will ask you to read 8 out of 12 sentences.
Please read sentence 1. Now read sentence 4. Now read sentence 5.
If you are doing the Versant through the phone, you will be given a paper. On that paper are the sentences that you are going to read, and the voice prompt will tell you which number to read, which sentence to read. But if you're doing the Versant in the computer, then you will see the sentences flashed on your screen. Reading items are grouped into sets of four sequentially coherent sentences. This means that three or four sentences are related to each other, that they follow the same storyline. So it's going to be less confusing for you when you shift from one sentence to another. This part will specifically test your pronunciation and reading fluency. And needless to say, this is the easiest part of the test because you're only going to be reading. I am pretty sure that this part of the test is going to be super hard to fail. So if you went to elementary or high school, you should be able to pass this test with flying colors. I think the only tip that I can give you here is to make sure that you pause on the places where you're supposed to pause, like commas, and try to group the sentences in phrases. That's basically how you read them. And again, this is going to be super easy. In fact, the difficulty of part A is 1/5. And I checked the Versant website and they say that the readings appear first in the test because for many candidates, reading aloud presents a familiar task and is a comfortable introduction to the interactive mode of the test as a whole, which means that they put part A, reading, as the first stage of the test to warm you up. This is just a warm-up, so you don't have to worry about this part of the test, okay? And the part B is repeat. In this task, you will be asked to repeat each of the statements that you hear verbatim. Verbatim means word for word. You should not omit or add anything. Just repeat the sentences as they are.
Please repeat each sentence that you hear. For example, a voice says,
"Leave town on the next train."
And you say,
"Leave town on the next train."
This part is made up of 16 items. Each sentence will be made up of 3 to 15 words. The items will also be arranged in an increasing order of difficulty, which means the first item will be the easiest. It will probably be made up of 3 words in a sentence.
Put that down, please.
Put that down, please. And as you progress and reach number 16, you will be asked to repeat the longest and most difficult sentence.
Actually, I read somewhere that social media ads aren't that effective anymore.
Actually, I read somewhere that social media ads aren't that effective anymore. The audio item prompts are also going to be conversational. There are sentences that you're going to hear from conversations. In fact, according to the Versant website, the voices of the item prompts are from native speakers of English from several different regions in the US, providing a range of speaking styles. So expect to hear different accents from different speakers and different gender. Overall, this test will assess your mastery of phrase and sentence structure and your ability to recognize speech into linguistic units. This stage of the test will also help the Versant software assess your fluency and pronunciation in continuous spoken English. So my tip for part B is just make sure that you repeat all the words that you hear. If you don't understand one word of the sentence, make sure that you repeat the others that you do understand. The goal is to avoid dead air if it is your time to answer. This is going to be a little bit harder than part A, but in comparison with the other parts, this is 2/5 level of difficulty. So you should be able to pass this test with not much of a problem. So another tip that I can give you for this stage is to listen to as much English materials as you can. Listen to conversational English so you will be able to understand. And when you do understand, you will be able to repeat each sentence that you hear during the test. And the next part is Part C, which is all about short answer questions. So in this task, you will be listening to questions and you will answer them. Do not worry because the questions are going to be super simple. They are questions that will require common sense answers. For example,
do horses have paws or hooves?
Hooves.
Is sea water salty or sweet?
Salty. Does a unicycle have one or two wheels?
One.
According to the Versant website, each question asks for basic information or requires simple inferences based on time, sequence, number, lexical content, or logic. The questions do not presume any knowledge of specific facts of culture, geography, history, or other subject matter. They are intended to be within the realm of familiarity of both a typical 12-year-old native speaker of English and an adult who has never lived in an English-speaking country. And again, you don't have to worry too much about what to answer. The questions will require very simple answers. So just like Part B, the difficulty level of this part is 2/5. You should be able to pass this test with not much of a problem. So my tip for this part is to just make sure that you are giving the correct answer and that you are pronouncing each word or phrase clearly, so the Versant software will be able to detect your answer. I hear a lot of people who are saying that even if you give the wrong answer to the questions in this part, if you just pronounce them well and clearly, you should be able to get point, which I don't think is true, but again, I could be wrong because, again, voice recognition technology couldn't be this dumb. If Google can already detect what we are saying when we're using its voice search feature, how much more for a software that's specifically designed to assess the human language? So it goes without saying that you just give the correct answer during the test and you should be safe. And the part D is sentence builds. In sentence builds, you will be hearing three short phrases in random order, excluding, of course, the original order. And your task is to arrange them in a way that makes sense and into the right grammatical order. According to Versant, to correctly complete this task, a candidate must understand the possible meanings of the phrases and know how they might combine with other phrasal material, both with regard to syntax and pragmatics. So in short, you just need to figure out what makes sense and arrange them in a way that sounds right to your ear and brain. This will measure your ability to access and retrieve lexical items and to build phrases and clause structures automatically. The more automatic these processes are, the better. So part D has a lot to do with your spontaneity with the language. So if you haven't already, check out my video on how to improve your English, especially with your spontaneity. And I will link it up here at the top corner of this video. This test will also measure your sentence mastery, pronunciation, and fluency. So my tip for this part is to just improve your English, especially with your speaking and spontaneity. I'm afraid nobody can help you here but you yourself. It's going to be just you and your English fluency. Because if you have a high or at least enough level of fluency, you should be able to figure out what makes sense and what doesn't. So you will only be able to survive the 10 items of Part D with your fluency. So again, this is just going to be between you, Versant, and your fluency. And now we have reached the hardest part of the test, and that is Part E, story retelling. Ooh, how do I put this? I must say that this is the hardest part of the test. You will be hearing three short stories. Each story will be composed of 3 to 6 sentences or 30 to 90 words. It's basically a short story, but your task is to retell the story in your own words. You have 30 seconds to describe in your own words. And when you're retelling the story, you have to include the situation, the character, the actions, and ending. What I find really hard in this test is you have to do a lot of things at once. Not only is this about your comprehension, your pronunciation, and fluency, this is also about your short-term memory. Because in this part of the test, there are information that you need to remember accurately. For example, the character names. Character names should be accurate. You should never get them wrong. The places, the events. And another problem is, during the test, the stories will only be repeated once. Not twice, but once. So it makes remembering extremely hard. On top of that, you are extremely nervous during the test. Mix all these things together. It is normal to feel that you don't know what you're doing. So yeah, hands down, Part E, I think, is the hardest part of the test. I think even harder than Part F. Because in Part F, you don't have to memorize anything. You just have to give your point of view. But in this test, it's extremely hard. You have to hone your short-term memory for you to be able to retain the information that needs accuracy. Versant says that Part E is as hard as Part F, that they are both 5 over 5 in difficulty. But I disagree with that. I think that story retelling, this part, is the hardest of them all. But is passing this impossible? No, passing this part of the test is absolutely possible. You just have to expect that you will make mistakes while you're retelling the story. But to increase your chance of passing this test, here are my tips. First, I want you to feel the story, to understand the big picture of the story. So while the story is being told, I want you to maybe close your eyes and just picture out what is going on in the story. You know when you're reading or listening to a story and you have this mental picture in your head that you're seeing while you're listening or reading a story? I want you to embrace that process and just immerse yourself in the story. Try to remember as much as you can of what happened during the story. Just understand the big picture of it. And while you're picturing out the story, while you're immersing yourself in the story, I want you to also, at the same time, remember the information that require accuracy, like the name of the characters, especially the name of the characters. They are very important. The numbers, the dates, the places, but the most important are the characters in the story. You need to remember who the characters are while you are experiencing the story in your head. The problem is you're not allowed to take notes. You're not allowed to bring a pen and paper during the test. So you really cannot have a pen and paper help you to at least retain some of the information that you need to remember. For example, in this short story that I included 4 days ago in my mock Versant test, the information that you need to remember here are Olivia, Jerry, Tom, Kitchen, 911. These are the information that you need to remember accurately. It is important that you don't miss them when you're retelling the story. There are, however, words that you don't have to accurately retell. For example, for burglar, you can just say intruder. For horror movie, you can say horror film. For loud bang in the kitchen, you can just say noise in the kitchen. I think it's important that when you're taking Part E, you have this mental filter of the information that you need to remember and the things that you don't have to remember that well. I think the best thing that I can do for you here is to make another mock Versant with Parts E and F, or maybe D, E, or F. What do you think? The more you practice, the more you will be able to improve your chances at passing this test, especially these stages, which are the hardest. The parts A to D, they are not that much of a problem if you have a decent level of English. But parts E and F, especially the E, are the hardest. So if you want me to make more mock Versant for parts E and F, just comment down below so I can upload them as soon as possible and you can practice. And also, you don't have to memorize it word for word. You just have to decide automatically which information to remember and which information to let go. So as you can see in this example, there was no need to repeat each sentence word for word. Olivia was watching a horror movie when she heard a loud bang from her kitchen. Convinced that it was a burglar, she screamed for help. Jerry, her neighbor, heard her scream and rushed to her house to see what was wrong. When he arrived, Olivia was about to dial 911, but Jerry immediately stopped her, for the figure that emerged from the kitchen was not a burglar, but Jerry's missing cat, Tom. Olivia was watching a horror movie. Suddenly, she heard a loud bang from her kitchen. She thought that it was a burglar, so she screamed for help. Her neighbor Jerry heard her and immediately went to her house to see what was going on. When Jerry arrived at Olivia's house, he saw Olivia was about to dial 911 and immediately stopped her because it turned out that the one causing the loud bang was Jerry's missing cat, Tom. It's different from part B, where you need to repeat the sentences verbatim. In this part, you have to use your own words. So it's important that you have to improve your short-term memory, which you will be able to do with constant practice and with this specific exercise. And second, that you improve your English. It goes without saying, this is a test for your English fluency. So you will be able to retell the story more automatically if you have enough words in your head to retell the story. And now we have reached the last part of the test, which is part F, or open questions. Like part E, according to Versant, the level of difficulty of part F is the same as part E. But I personally think that part E is still harder than part F, but oh well. For part F, you will be listening to spoken questions, two questions. The good thing about this is the questions are going to be repeated twice. So you will have time to think and construct your answer in your head while listening to the question. In this task, candidates listen to spoken questions that elicit an opinion and are asked to provide an answer with an explanation. Candidates have 40 seconds to respond to each question. By the way, there are no right or wrong answers to these questions. Questions are going to be asking for your opinion, so there is no such thing as right or wrong answer. You just have to express your opinion and support your opinion. That is the goal of this test. The questions relate to day-to-day issues or the candidate's preferences and choices. This task is used to collect longer, spontaneous speech samples. Again, you need to talk normally like you would in a conversation, like this. From your point of view, is it better to live in a tropical climate or a temperate climate? Please explain your answer. From your point of view, is it better to live in a tropical climate or a temperate climate? Please explain your answer. I think that it's way better to live in a tropical climate than in a temperate climate, and that's for two reasons. First, obviously, is the weather. I haven't personally experienced winter myself, but I don't think that it's something that I'm going to be thrilled with. Second, and the most important reason for me, is the fruit. I think that the fruits in a tropical climate are way tastier than the ones in a temperate climate. Durian and mango, for example, are fruits that do not grow in temperate climate, and I wouldn't want to miss them just to live in a temperate climate. So as you heard in that recording, I sounded like I was in a conversation talking to another person. And that's because this test is going to measure your spontaneous speech when speaking in English. So again, it's important to develop your spontaneity when speaking in English. And again, I'm going to link the video up here where I talk about how to speak in English more automatically. If you apply the principle in that video, you should be able to increase your chances at passing Versant. And according to Versant, candidates' responses to items in this section are not scored, but are available for review by authorized listeners. So it sounds like this part of the test, part F, is not going to be assessed by the Versant software, but by an actual human. Obviously, you want to make sure that you are answering the question as best as you can. Avoid dead air. Make sure that you are talking in the majority of the allotted 40 seconds of the test. For example, here's one of the sample answers to a part F question. Notice that the answer that you're going to hear in this example will be using the PREP framework. PREP, by the way, stands for point, reason, explanation or examples, and back to point. Do you agree that social media has a negative impact on people's lives? Why or why not? Do you agree that social media has a negative impact on people's lives? Why or why not? In my opinion, I definitely agree that social media has a negative impact on people's lives. And a lot of that has something to do with insecurities. We humans are created to compare. I know a lot of people are saying that we should stop comparing ourselves to other people, but the thing is, it's human nature. And when we browse social media and when we do it regularly, we see these picture-perfect lives of other people. We know that they are touched-up versions of their themselves. We know that they are somewhat scripted, but we can't help but compare. Not saying that we should stop using social media, but it should be something that we should use in moderation. So, as you can see, when you're using the prep technique to answer the questions in part F, you will not run out of things to say, so you will be able to avoid dead air until the 40 seconds. And second, you will be able to express your answer in a more structured way that the listener will be able to understand better and understand your perspective. Of course, you will still have to practice to be able to express your answer in this technique. But once you get used to it, you should be able to pass part F. So again, if you want me to make more mock Versant recordings with a focus for parts E and F, then comment down below so I will be able to make them as soon as possible. So you will be able to practice with the recordings and have a better chance of passing the Versant test. And the last tip that I forgot to mention in this video is if you get one item wrong and the time for you to answer that question or that item is up, make sure to forget about that question or item immediately and proceed to what's right in front of you, to what you're currently answering. Of course, you want to make sure to answer each question correctly, but if you cannot answer this question, try to forget about it immediately and just focus on what's in front of you, on the question or the item that's in front of you, and answer that as best as you can. This way, you're only going to mess up the items that you didn't know, but the other items that you do know are unaffected, and you will be able to answer them correctly. Okay, guys, that is all for today. If you need to practice Versant, I'm going to put the link at the top right corner of this video, so you will be able to practice before your test. But if you need more mock Versant materials to practice on, especially for parts E and F, comment down below and let me know so you will have better chances of passing this test. All right, that is all for today. Bye.